H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys supports 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus. One-time pay, lifetime access to live classes and videos. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For free demo class, visit h2kinfosys.com.
Welcome to the videos of H2K Infosys. So we'll continue about the Java language as a whole. So in the last video, we saw the installation of JRE, which is a prerequisite for installing the Eclipse IDE. So let's see what are the steps involved to install Eclipse IDE. The first step that we require to install our Eclipse IDE is to first check out the system type, and that is defined out here. So we'll see how to check up the system types, and then download Eclipse IDE for Java EE developers. This is the flavor of Eclipse that we are going to use. We're going to use the Java EE developers Eclipse IDE because then we can create frameworks very easily, and we can create enterprise level application very easily. So the Eclipse IDE for Java EE developers will be downloaded based on the fact that what platform do we have in our systems and what are the system type that we have. Platform can be Windows, Linux, or Mac. So we have Eclipse IDE for Java EE developers for the Mac platform, for the Windows platform, for the Linux platform. So based on the platform that we have and the system type that we have, we're going to download that particular flavor of Eclipse IDE for Java EE developers. So after we download Eclipse IDE for Java EE developers, then we're going to install Eclipse IDE for Java EE developers in our system. Now, before I do this particular step, let me make you understand what is an IDE. An IDE is nothing but an interface development environment. It provides an environment to create codes, to debug codes, and to run codes. So Eclipse is an IDE for Java platform or for Java language as a whole. So this Eclipse IDE will provide us lot of facilities which will ease our coding structure in our coding process. We can create Java codes, we can run our Java codes and check the results, and we can debug the codes for looking at the syntax error or logical errors by using this Eclipse IDE. There are other IDEs also available in the market for creating Java codes. The other IDE can be from Oracle, and the IDE from Oracle is called as NetBeans. I personally find that the features of Eclipse IDE are better than the features of NetBeans. That is why I will use Eclipse IDE, and the flavor that is going to be used is for Java EE developers. Now the next question arises is that why do we require the JRE for the installation of Eclipse IDE in our systems? Now first of all, when we try to install Eclipse IDE, Eclipse as a whole, the software as a whole tries to look at the JRE path and tries to find out that JRE is installed in our system or not. If Eclipse finds out that JRE is not installed in our systems, it'll throw an error and Eclipse will not get installed. The second reason is that for the projects that we create inside Eclipse IDE, each project requires the JRE system library. Now, why each project created inside Eclipse IDE requires the JRE system library? The reason is that the JRE system library contains a lot of classes and methods which are used or can be used by you or me in order to ease our coding structure or our coding process. So that is why each project that we create inside the Eclipse IDE would be connected with the JRE system library. We will see what is a project in Eclipse IDE and what are these other hierarchy levels that are present in your Eclipse IDE. We'll see that. But at this point of time, let us go and install Eclipse IDE for Java EE developers. So first we'll check up the system type. So what we are going to do is highlight computer, right click, go to properties. And in my system, I have a 64-bit operating system. You can see that out here. And the operating system is Windows. That means the platform is Windows. The OS is Windows 10 rather. So based on the platform and the system type, we're going to download Eclipse IDE for Java EE developers. How do we download it? We got to open the Google search and just write down this particular keyword called download Eclipse. And click on the enter button. Click on the first link that we see out here. And in this first link, you will see get Eclipse Marts. Don't click on the download 64-bit. There is a link called download packages. So click on that. Okay. So since I have a 64-bit operating system, I will click this particular link to download the 64-bit flavor of Eclipse IDE for Java EE developers. Okay. I have a 32-bit. I will download this particular part. Now, I'm very particular about the flavor because this flavor gives me lot of ease in creating codes at the enterprise level. So I will download Eclipse IDE for Java EE developers, as I have told you earlier. And since I have 64-bit, I will download it from this particular link. If you have a 32-bit operating system, just go out here and click in this particular link. So since I have 64-bit, I'll click out here. We can see that it starts downloading after some time. Still not started. That means it is telling me to choose the mirror. So I will choose the same mirror given out here, that is the Chinese University. So I'll click on this particular button called download. And it should start downloading. So it has started downloading right now. So it's a 276 MB file. We can see that. Take a bit of time. So what I'm going to do is pause the video and then come back when the software gets downloaded. So, okay, great. So it has got downloaded completely. It took a bit of amount of time because the file was 276 MB. Now, generally in my Chrome browser, the configuration is done in such a manner that all the downloads that I do gets downloaded in a particular folder called downloads. So if I click out here and I want to see the file in the folder, I just have to click on show in folder. This is the file. And if you see the file has a zip extension. That means you need to unzip it. And for unzipping it, you need, you know, the WinZip software on the WinRAR software. So download the WinZip or the WinRAR software based on the system type that you have. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to basically cut it from this particular folder. And I'm going to change the path where I'm going to keep this particular zip file. Generally, I keep it in my own path that I have defined. And I keep it in this particular path because the other flavors of Eclipse which were released earlier are also kept in the same path. You can keep it anywhere if you wish. So this is the version that we have downloaded. Okay. And what we are going to do is we're going to first unzip this version and I will extract the files in the same path. So what I didn't need to do, I have a WinRAR software. I will right click and I'll use extract out here. This is going to extract the file in the same path. So let's wait for some time for the extraction to happen completely. Sorry, I have a bad cold. So extraction has happened. After the extraction, we will see this particular folder called Eclipse. So open up this particular folder, you will see a lot of subfolders and other files. One of the files is the executable file of Eclipse. So if I double click on this executable file, Eclipse will open and it will try to find the GRE software and connect with the GRE software. So every time I want to open the Eclipse IDE, I need to go on to this particular path open up the Eclipse folder and then click on this particular exe, and that's cumbersome and irritating. So what we need to do is that, what I do rather is right click and I send it to my desktop, create a shortcut. So after that, I will see that the Eclipse comes out here as a shortcut. Then I do a double click out here. The moment I do double click, the Eclipse tries to find the GRE file. And when it finds the GRE file, it opens up the Eclipse IDE. When we are opening it for the first time, it takes a bit amount of time to open. And while it is opening, it will ask for the workspace. Now, workspace is nothing but a folder where Eclipse keeps all projects, all classes present inside the project, and other files required for Eclipse to work in the system. So let's see that and have some patience for the Eclipse to open. Now it works, it basically is looking for a workspace out here. So what we can do is, let's say we go to a particular, we browse, click on the browse button, and we want to create a workspace, let's say on the desktop. And you can create a new folder on the desktop by clicking on make new folder. And here you can give the name as, let's say, workspace for, let's say, training. That is the work, that is the name of the workspace that I have given. So in this particular folder called workspace underscore training, Eclipse will keep all the projects that I create inside the Eclipse IDE and all the class files that I create inside the project. Plus also Eclipse is going to keep all other files required for Eclipse to work with my system. This is the workspace created. So I'll highlight this particular workspace underscore training folder created and click on OK. If you see out here, the Eclipse is now pinpointing to the workspace that I've created, and then I have to click on the OK button. The moment I click on the OK button, it loads all the packages required for Eclipse to work along with the JRE. And in a small span of time, the IDE opens. So we'll maximize the IDE and we'll see the welcome screen. We don't want the welcome screen, so I can basically click on the cross button or the close button to close the welcome screen. And this is how the IDE looks like when we open it for the first time. So it has a project explorer pane in the left hand side where we actually create projects. And inside those projects, we'll have the class files where we actually write Java codes. This is the coding pane where I am basically hovering my mouse. This is the pane in which we write our codes. We don't need the outline tab and all. We'll see out all these things in a later point of time. We don't need the task list also. So this pane becomes the coding pane right now. And in below out here, we see a lot of tabs, markers tabs, property tabs, servers tab, data source explorer tab, snippets. Snippets tab basically shows you the code snippets, small chunk of codes. The data source explorer tab is basically used to connect the Eclipse IDE or the code that you have written in Java with the database. Servers are basically used to actually connect the Eclipse IDE with app servers or other servers which are present. One of the tabs which is absent out here is the console tab. The console tab needs to be out here in this particular pane with the other tabs which are present out here. The console tab is basically used by Eclipse throughout the result. Okay, and this result that will be thrown will be based on the Java codes that we write down. So when we write down the Java codes and we run those Java codes, the result of that Java code will be thrown in the console. Now we don't see the console out here in the Eclipse when we open it for the first time. So what we need to do is go to Windows and go to Show View and click on the console option. The moment we do that, the console tab comes out here, and it is in the console tab that the Eclipse ID will throw result on running a class file, or rather on running a Java code. So when we run a Java code, the console tab is the tab on which we are going to see the result of the executed Java code. So that's all for this particular session. Thanks very much and appreciate it for your time. See you in the next video.